for one, like, I've lived, so now I've lived in a van for 16 months. It feels like I've lived in a van for 5 years. Because my every day that I've lived in a van has been 2 to 3 times as full as every day that before.
Welcome, everybody, to the Chris and G Travels podcast. Today we have Simon on this episode. It was awesome to be able to sit down and talk to this guy. Even for me, somebody that's been traveling in vehicles for so many years, it's good to have a conversation like this. It's very refreshing. It's very engaging, very motivational. So I think you all will enjoy it. So without further ado, here's my conversation with Simon.
This is a Chris. He's got a cool channel.
Cool YouTube channel. Have you heard about YouTube?
Yeah, it's on the internet.
Everybody, what's going on? Chris here from Chris and G Travels. We have Simon here today. This is podcast. I don't know which podcast this will be, but it'll be coming up soon. We've been having a conversation about van life, RV life, traveling, and it's a conversation that I think people that watch my videos, people that enjoy YouTube videos, might enjoy. Simon's channel, be sure to plug that in here and people can subscribe.
We have a lot in common. So yeah. We've been traveling nomadically for a while. We're both on YouTube, so we have a lot, and we're talking gear. As soon as we get together, it's like shop talk.
Camera gear, brings
shop
his laptop
for
in.
Like hours.
Oh wait, how do you do that? Oh, that's a pretty good idea.
Yeah, just swapping notes.
Well, right now, what Simon is doing is what I was doing before I met G, bopping around the country in a van with my dog.
Yeah,
and basically, this guy's been traveling. Even though you're doing van life now, you're mentioning you have bigger, well, not bigger, but you have other traveling goals, thinking about doing a sailboat, thinking about doing off-the-grid cabin, and, you know, just getting out there and exploring and seeing what's out there. So what's been the biggest surprise to you on the road? I know, like, we haven't gone over any of these before. These are not huge questions. It's a huge
biggest
question.
Surprise,
but, like, whether it be the people, whether it be the freedom, be it being able to, you know, pursue your photography, like what's been kind of the biggest eye-opening experience you've had?
Well, cause there's a few things, but like the ones I didn't expect, for instance, you just meet people who have completely opposite points of view. So like I was hanging out with like a guy who was like an NRA guy, had guns all over the walls, and I actually enjoyed, he had so many interesting things to say, and he was, and he, like, the guy, if I would have thought online, you know, or my stereotype of that guy, wow, he's an idiot and I'll never pay attention to anything he says. This is because he thinks so differently than I do. But actually, he had, like, loads of stuff that was super interesting. I was sitting there taking notes, you know? Like, he was sharing, like, book lists and stuff that he had read that I've started reading some of the books he suggested.
It was fantastic.
So it's really interesting how, like, when you meet people in person when you're traveling, they're more interesting, more intelligent, more anything that you could possibly have stereotyped them for, having never met them.
They, like, actually become people.
Online. Yeah, the world online is nothing like it is in person.
Right, and we were kind of discussing some of the things with, you know, we're both doing YouTube, the good old comment section.
Yeah.
In YouTube, you get the keyboard cowboys.
Keyboard cowboys, but the thing is like, if you met that person in person, they'd probably be nothing like that.
Right.
It's so hard to understand what the complexity of who they actually are until you're there and face to face.
I mean, I kind of touched on this in a previous podcast, but for me, like, I don't know if you read the book called The Alchemist. Have you heard?
I just read it. I just read it a couple days ago. I can't believe you just brought that up.
That I've no exaggeration. I have read that book 10 through 15
really?
Times because it's one of those books for me. It's a book that speaks to someone.
It's like magic.
It is. And So definitely if you're watching this, check out The Alchemist, read it, audiobook, whatever. But there's a section in there, I believe it's The Alchemist talking, well, I don't want to ruin anything out of the book, but a character in the book is talking to another character and he's talking about dreams.
Yeah.
And people who don't pursue their dreams don't just go away. They die and rot inside of them and they fester.
Mm-hmm.
And I think with travel blog trolls, people that make negative comments, people traveling, doing whatever they're doing, I think those people, they had their dreams die for whatever reason, whether they got sick or they had to work or whatever. It's not a good
life
or a bad thing.
At them.
Right. And then when they see people doing what they might have dreamed of doing, it stirs that dead dream inside of them.
The interesting bit with that, though, is that, like, if you approach them in just the right way, you can rekindle that dreams. Instead of becoming a festering wound inside, suddenly it's a clean wound that needs healing.
Right.
And they will do things like that are just so open and welcoming and caring towards you to help you achieve your dreams.
Absolutely.
Suddenly. And it's weird how like that can switch back and forth, how that can be like a negative thing or how it can be a positive thing, you know.
Have you experienced that? Have you experienced someone that's kind of did a 180 on you?
There, you know, there's been people that have been on my comment section that have been like really like aggressively, you know, just crappy internet people. And then suddenly a couple months later, something different changes and I have a personal reach out from them on the email, or I'll talk to them over text or phone messaging something. And they'll like really help me out. And it's happened just recently. I won't like lay the details out because I don't want to point tell him that he was crappy before and now he's a great guy. But yeah, like they'll have people that are just like, yeah, they've been crappy to you in the past, and all of a sudden they'll, you know, as long as you just keep the, you got to be bigger than that, right? You got to be right. Positive. Hey champ, right. Give us a break. Bye bye.
So how is it living in the van with your dog? Because Kobuk is a wild man.
He takes
up
space, man. Your dog is like your dog is a little bit bigger than champ. Bye bye. Champ's persistent. We'll give him that.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.
It's a good quality to have.
But, no, Champ, he's very much a serious dog. So I think, like, in terms of taking out space, he has his own little corner, cuddles down in it, and that's his thing, you know, and he's not jumping all over every corner of the van all the time. So he's an easy dog to travel with.
And then you were saying your family was actually on an RV vacation when you picked him up.
Yeah, so he's been an RV dog for his whole life, pretty much, off and on. And he's also moved households quite a lot, you know. I didn't have him the whole time because I was in university and I had, like, housemates that didn't want dogs in the house. So he was with my parents for part of it, and then he's back with me. And then, you know, they're changing houses. So he's very comfortable being, like, with everybody. So he's the easiest travel partner on earth, probably.
That's awesome. So you two originally came down from Canada.
Yeah.
And now we're here in Arizona. Yeah. What do you think of traveling around this area? Are you a big fan of
best place on earth?
You think the Southwest
Arizona,
is the best?
Arizona and New Mexico are my two, like, my favorite place to be.
As long as you come here during the
winter.
The winter.
Yeah.
I guess you can go to the higher elevations. You can go to Flagstaff and
Flagstaff, Santa Fe, magical places. I love them. I love them. Santa Fe and Austin, Texas are probably my two favorite cities on earth.
What makes you enjoy those places? The people, the food,
everything. It's got all of it. It's got everything. And you know what? Hopefully, while I'm traveling, I'll find like dozens more cities I can say that about. But you know, just everything lines up just right for me.
Absolutely. And while you're on the road, how are you able to afford to, you know, get in the van, travel around, bounce around? How are you able to pull that off?
It's a cheap way of traveling, for one. Mm-hmm. You know, a van.
If
you do it right, it is the most affordable way of traveling. But I also, like, I work in the summers, especially as a photographer, and I do work on the road as well. And I also, like, I'm starting to make a little bit of revenue from YouTube. But the thing is with that, the overhead's so low. You can make a lot happen for very little. People overestimate what I make all the time, though.
That right, same.
Me crazy.
Same.
They're like always like, oh, it must be nice. It must be nice to have a YouTube channel just fund everything.
Right,
like,
right.
My YouTube channel, I had my most profitable month. My YouTube channel funded less than a quarter of the cost
right.
of my lifestyle.
No,
and I'm living like as cheaply as possible.
I had somebody in the comments again. We're talking about the comments, so
yeah.
bear with me here. But somebody's like,
things are getting degraded quickly here.
He was like, oh, Chris and G make an easy $5,000 to $5,500 per month.
Yeah.
And like I rarely laugh out loud at comments, and that was one.
Well, there's like an intonation, right? There's like people will say it, but they won't say the actual number. They'll be like, oh, like just it's like a passive comment. They'll say it passively. They'll just it like sounds like they think that you make a ton off it, but when somebody actually lays down a number, boy, is it ever funny, eh?
Yeah, yeah. It's like if that was the case, sir, then I'd be living a completely different, like our lifestyle. Like I think we boondock literally 90% of the time.
Yeah.
I'd say out of, like while we're traveling, we're in Seward, we work camp. So we get a spot, but I'd say we actually have full hookups, water, power, electric, maybe 20 days out of the year.
Yeah. I, you know? Over the last 2 years, I've had three campsites.
three nights I've paid for a campsite. Once was a Big Sur, because when I started out, I didn't know much about boondocking, and I wanted to camp near the water at Big Sur, so I feel like I got a decent deal out of it. Austin, near Austin, Texas, a friend of mine was, there was three people in that van for a few days, and she wanted to, like, get a campfire going, and I didn't know enough about, like, BLM and stuff to make it happen, so I paid for a campsite. Mm-hmm. And then... yeah, again, that friend was traveling with me and we couldn't find anything close to Toronto. It was like, it had to be like a half an hour drive from her place in Toronto because we were that rushed. And the campsite was so not a campsite, you could order pizza to your campsite.
Like, you could order, pretty fancy, huh?
Order delivery pizza to your campsite.
So with costs, and this is kind of, again...
I'll lay out all my numbers.
Off the cuff. How much do you think you've spent living the lifestyle that includes your food, not including your gear, because we were talking, you had some pretty big purchases for your camera gear.
Yeah, yeah.
But your living expenses, your traveling,
your food.
It
costs
me
$2,200 on average per month while I'm traveling.
Per month.
$2,200, yeah.
And that's insurance, phone?
Insurance, phone, gas, food, everything. $2,200.
And
which is not bad.
Is that average? Is that, you
that's
know?
That's average on the months where I'm traveling all the way out from Ontario to the West Coast, for instance, that I would spend a bit more. And then, you know, once I'm here, I spend a bit less. It averages out. And that's also including, you know, a certain allowance for repairs. So, like, 1 month I might, like, this month I did rotors and stuff. That wasn't too bad.
Right.
It wasn't too expensive. But, like, I'll have to get tires next month probably.
And that's not cheap. That is not cheap at all.
Yeah.
So, when it, like, I'm sure the money aspect is a misconception people, you know, think about. Are there any other major misconceptions about what you're doing
people
right
think,
now?
People think finding campsites or where you're going to sleep at night is really hard. Hmm. People think, like, where do you shower? Where do you go to the bathroom? Where do you camp at night? Those are the three concerns. They think it's so hard. Mm-hmm. Like, those are the easiest things.
Right.
Like, the hardest part is learning to never have a single constant. Like, everywhere I go, even, like, the one of the ones is the lesson that keeps teaching me over and over again, going to fill a propane. I'm like, well, as soon as I think I know a good spot to consistently get you propane while I'm traveling, I'll go to the next one and won't have it. They'll be like, oh, U-Hauls always have propane. And I'll get to, like, Nevada, where U-Hauls don't have propane. Or also, like, you know, something like that. It'd be like,
I didn't realize that was a thing. So yeah, Nevada U-Hauls don't have propane.
That's
an example.
Like, a bad example, but, like, it was just stuff like that. Like, I'd be like, oh, I always get dump stations at these particular spots, and then I'll go to the next one and it won't have it. Or it's always, like, BLM is always dispersed while camping, and then I went to a BLM one that was an actual, like, I had to check in with the camp host just, like, a couple days ago.
Really? Where was that?
Lake Havasu. They have
a
BLM spot where you had to check in with the host. It was a great spot. It was still free, but, like, that was technically BLM.
It's getting to that time of year where everybody's coming in, they need camp hosts at BLM just to make sure things are...
Yeah. So, it's just like a, you know, or like national parks are always, it always costs money to get in a national park, and I go into certain areas, all of a sudden it's free. One particular things line up and it's just, or, you know, you can't disperse camp in national parks. Actually you can, sometimes, but not all the time. And then sometimes things are totally different. And, you know, there's no consistency. That's one of the hardest things. You just learn that there's zero consistency when you're traveling. Everything changes all the time.
Well, you say it's hard, but I mean, have you adapted, or is it still something that kind of
irks
you from time to time?
From time to time. I would say, like, it used to bother me 100% of the time. Now it bothers me 10% of the time. Mm-hmm. I'm learning to get over it. That's a lesson that I think I'm close to learning.
Well, yeah, recently. I mean, when you travel around in a van and then you have a motorbike as secondary transportation, there's going to be things that pop up that you're going to have to deviate from what you're thinking. You have to internalize, okay, this is just part of the lifestyle.
Yeah.
If I'm doing this, I need to roll the punches, because otherwise I'm going to pull my hair out and go nuts.
It's a nomadic life. That's the whole point, right?
Yeah.
If you want to take the good of nomadic life, you got to take the not so good. And that's a key one.
Are there any other not so good aspects that you can think of that people don't really think about? I mean, you have the obvious
stuff.
I'm sure
there's loads for people who have different lifestyles than me and different expectations. Mm-hmm. But for me personally, like, the way I, what is important to me, like, having a lot of space isn't very important to me. Mm-hmm. Having security isn't that important to me. You know, these are things I don't really worry about. So for me, like, those concerns, which would be major for a lot of other people, they don't affect me much.
Right. And we were talking just recently about how open you are to meeting people on the road.
Yeah.
And
that's one of the biggest assets for having a YouTube channel, sharing everything, is that you get hookups, you get connections, you get weird opportunities. Like last night I stayed with a crew in, with a V-dub club. And I rolled in with my big ass. They're like, "Are you with the Volkswagen crew?" And I was like, "Yeah, man. Did you tell?" And I got into this park for free. I got a free campsite. I got a free shower at the deal. And then I also got to meet like a really cool crowd. And they all like welcomed me in. And got to go swim in a lake with a bunch of like people I met for the first time that day. And we're all like instantly friends. It was a cool vibe.
Absolutely. Live. I mean, I feel like it takes. I mean, everybody has their catalyst to live this lifestyle. Everybody has their reasons.
Yeah.
But at the same time, what I've found is when it boils down to actually meeting those people in real life, you have so much in common.
Yeah,
you know, the way you kind of view things, the way, oh, not so much view things, the way, the overall scope of things, mm-hmm. the ability to take a step back and, you know, look at the situation objectively, being able to live in smaller spaces, be it a van or an RV, people call it small, you know. And I feel like there is that common trend.
So much. There's so much that we have in common. Find. Yeah, it's hard to find your differences sometimes.
Oh yeah,
because there's just too much in common.
So with the negative parts that you find difficult, what are some of the ultimate positives that you've come across? I mean, being able to wake up and have beautiful views every morning. That's obvious, but. Any of the caveats that you
wasn't
found?
Expecting?
Yeah.
For one, like I've lived in a van for 16 months. It feels like I've lived in a van for 5 years because my every day that I've lived in a van has been 2 to 3 times as full as every day that before.
Absolutely.
There's way more going on, especially the YouTube. Now that I'm documenting it and I can look back on my life too, like it's just so much more has happened in the last year and a half than previous like 3 or 4 years.
You do get a lot of cramped into one space of time. Like you're doing so much each and every day.
Like today is an average day and it's nuts. Like it's just it's crazy.
Let's go over your day. Like start the morning.
So this morning I woke up with a brutal hangover from the previous night's libations with friends over someone's birthday party, who is a complete stranger to me until that night. I met him that night and it was his birthday and like I left one of his friends. Like it was a fantastic way to live. I woke up, met more of the V-dub crowd, got some tours of vans, met a bunch of folks that way. Then everyone started pulling out. We went over to a lake with a bunch of V-dubs. We went swimming. Well, I was the only one who went swimming because I'm a Canadian and everyone else has said it was way too cold.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a sauna out here for you.
Yeah, I got like, showers and stuff all sorted. Working on the van, did a little bit of work on the computer, and then I like drive through this Joshua Tree area, stop for lunch, like surrounded by Joshua trees and really like surreal kind of magical place all of a sudden just be stuck in. Mm-hmm. And then I drove up the hill to like one of the most spectacular landscapes and I ended up here meeting you, which was huge because I've been watching your videos for like 2 years.
It's crazy how small the world is whenever you're traveling, the people you meet and the opportunities you have. And I really like that analogy that you put forward where it seems as though you've lived in a van 5 years because you've packed so much.
Yeah, every day is just way too packed. That was today, and this is like, it's 5 o'clock now. You know, I've lived a pretty crazy, and that's just an average. Like tomorrow it's going to be, I'm going to see probably a national park tomorrow. And
right.
I'm going to go to like, through a bunch of stuff, drive for 4 hours probably on my way to Santa Fe. And that'll be, tomorrow's like a really slow day and I'll probably do all of that, you know. And I'll probably go like dirt biking tomorrow too. And who knows?
It's crazy to see that in motion, like as you're doing it, because what I notice sometimes from time to time, and it'll be weird times that I catch myself doing it. I'll be brushing my teeth or I'll be reaching in the fridge to grab food. And I realize I'm living, like what I'm doing day after day is what people get to experience on a weekend or something, or on a vacation.
Your weekender life. I was about to say, because like, the average person working a 9-to-5 literally spends probably 3 days a week where they don't do anything. Like, they'll go to work, they'll do all their chores, they'll do their daily day. But if you ask them what they did that day, they'd say nothing. Because to them, like, they haven't done anything today.
Mm-hmm.
Like, when was the last time you did nothing in a day? I did nothing and it was noteworthy. I was so sick, I sat down and watched TV all day. And that was like, it was a noteworthy day where I sat and watched movies all day.
See,
because I was sick and it was raining.
I haven't had one of those days. Like, it's crazy. Yeah, I don't know if it's the human condition or whatever, but I daydream about possibly having one of those days where I just sit front of Netflix or Xfinity with coffee in the morning, then a couple drinks at night, and then just that's my day.
Yeah.
Like, I haven't had, I can't think of the last time I had a day like that.
And you know, so many people that they do that like 3 days a week at least.
Every week.
Could you imagine?
No. Well, when I did my college internship, that's...
You know, and that's the thing. That was my life at some point. At some point, like, I went to work and I came home and I watched TV and that was it.
And those days of doing nothing, I was so burnt out from working the 9-to-5 and doing something I hated doing. I would sit in front of the TV and play Halo from sun up to sundown. Then I might go out with my roommate to a bar and then drink and... wake up the next day and maybe I might go work out, but I probably wouldn't do much just because I was so burnt out. I didn't feel like doing anything. Where now it's like the work that I do, even though it's not too profitable, but
that's fulfilling though.
Right. The work I do now, I wake up and I actually feel like a draw to my computer to work.
Right. This is the other thing too, right? This started before my van dwelling, but this started when I started doing photography full time. When I quit my last job was a sushi chef at a restaurant, and I quit it quite dramatically, I might add.
How did that happen?
This is nitty gritty details, but it involved throwing a $3,000 sushi knife out a window and, and like my boss throwing things at me. A lot of stuff got thrown in the restaurant that day. It was not a good day, but I was
not blazing glory.
I was homicidal. Like at that point, like it was so crappy. It was such a crappy place to be in a point in my life that I quit. And I was like, I decided, okay, today or tomorrow I'm going to hunt for a job, but I'm going to spend every hour I spend hunting for jobs, I'll hunt for gigs.
Right.
For my photography, because I was already working a photographer part-time, making half my income off that. So I was like, you know what, I'm going to gig hunt as hard as I job hunt. And then eventually the gigs kept rolling in, the jobs didn't, and I just kept going. But the next morning I woke up at 6 a.m. and I was instantly, I had to get out of bed, I had to get to my computer to start working because I was like excited. I was
right.
So excited, and I've lived like that every single day since.
There's two feelings that can come from your gut. And not that, you know, old cliche, go with your gut, but like that actual feeling that you get.
Excitement.
Yeah, it's like excitement to do something or that sinking.
Yeah.
The polar opposite, the night and day difference. There's that sinking feeling of, oh,
yeah,
I gotta do this. I mean, not saying that one.
That's when I've like not sent a client an email.
Right.
And I know that it's been too late. And now at every minute that I wait longer, it's like, it's just making it worse, but I can't send that email.
Right.
For me, communication's a big one like that. I can't
handle
it. It drives me crazy.
I mean, from time to time, I need to take a break from the YouTube. Sometimes I get so burnt out, or the video editing or the social media marketing, you know, some days I do need just to be away from the computer. But at the same time, when you're in places like this, it's easy to look at that, like we're talking about climbing mountains and rocks, be like, okay, I'm just going to walk up there today and explore.
I have a sprained ankle and I want to go climb that mountain. it's
a different type of lifestyle, different type of mentality. But I think once you actually get into it, once you start living it, it's not so much of an idea of a lifestyle. It's not so much of like this outward thing that can't be achieved. It's like you actually become it and you start realizing it. And once that, you know, that time happens where that snap, where you actually move from thinking about it to doing it.
Yeah.
That's when you, for me.
You took the first step. Momentum is easy after that.
But I think for you too, you can probably agree once you get past that certain point, there's really no going back. Like I can't imagine.
Now I got a taste for it. I can't stop.
I think that's why the videos are popular and people reach out to it, because they have the same desire. You know, whether they're doing it or not, they have the same, you know, inward motion. Like what we're talking about communicates to them, and it's something that they can see themselves doing, but they just have to take that very first step. Do you have I mean, granted, you're living the life now. Do you have any advice for people that are on the cusp, that are getting ready to start this lifestyle, be it a van, RV, or even just quitting their job and working remotely?
Mm-hmm.
You know, taking that first step. What would you tell them?
Well, I like, so it sounds, it's really rich coming from a guy who's 27, has no kids, has no,
right.
No responsibility, really. So like, I'm probably the worst person in the world to give this kind of advice, because I'd just be like, oh, just follow your dreams, man. You know, like, but,
right.
But straight up, what I learned is that you will tell yourself the things you can't do because you have these commitments or whatever. But always know that there, you can always, like, I can go and fly to Southeast Asia right now. Like, I could go do that. I choose not to because I have the van and there's, I have all these other things holding me back right now. But I say that that's the thing holding me back, but it's really just me. Like, I could go sell that van tomorrow. I could go sell my motorcycle. I could go figure out where Champ's going to live because he can't come with me, or if, or figure out a way for him to come with me or whatever. I can make it happen. It's a lot of work, but you can always do it.
Right.
You can always do it. It's just, how much are you willing to give up? And here's the point. It's like, people, sometimes maybe people just don't realize how good it is, the thing that they're hunting, whatever it is, whether it's this lifestyle or whether it's something else, you just don't, you undervalue how good it's going to be. And so you aren't willing to sacrifice for it.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're like, well, you know, it's, and then once you've convinced your mind itself that it's better than the sacrifice is worth, like, so it's worth giving up those things
right.
for, and then you finally do it.
Then,
but it's often what's happened, what will have happened is it was always way better. It's just, it took you forever to realize that. And then once you do, you sacrifice.
And the fear of something happening is, you know, typically much worse than the actual thing happening.
Yeah. Built, that's the other thing too. When I got the van, that was a big one. Everyone who gets their first whatever and they're wrenching it on themselves, especially, you're like constantly driving, you're fearing something breaking down. You're fearing of your motorcycle or your bicycle getting stolen off the back. That fear is way worse than it actually happening.
Always, oh yeah. Always. And then,
because when it does, you just solve the problem because it relies in your lap and you can't do
absolutely,
anything solve
absolutely.
It.
And you learn from it, and you sometimes you learn profound things. One of the happiest moments, one of the most clear moments I've ever had in my life is when I had my van, like Zep, the very first time I took it across country, it kept breaking down. I ended up finding out it was the fuel pump. But what happened was the fuel pump would stall. It'd be no fuel.
I remember that.
And then all of a sudden, dump fuel into the combustion chamber and it'd shoot up. So you know the story.
Yeah,
like
coughing, fire coming up the top.
Yeah, so
I had
those good old Dodge vans.
Good old fire coming up the top.
But yeah, I got the fire extinguisher out. I had to put it out and all the dust got in the upper intake, and I ended up taking it all out. I was getting frustrated. I was sweaty over the engine. You know, I was super frustrated. I walk outside. I'm next to this interstate. Semis are going by. Like, this is like 3 a.m, you know?
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it was really quiet. And I looked up and the stars were just gorgeous. It was in the middle of nowhere. I was looking away from, you know, Albuquerque. So, you know, I was looking the way the light pollution was behind me. We were that far outside of town. And I just sat there for like 15, 20 minutes, just like completely in the moment.
This is where you are now.
Right. Yeah, this is what's happening, what's behind me, I need to take care of. And like literally stood up whenever I was ready, went back to the van. You know, the engine had cooled down by then. I got in there, strapped the flashlight onto the dash, and then, you know, put one flashlight on the chair.
It's weird how that sits as a moment.
Flight. Yeah.
In your head. There's a moment where things change. I have a very similar moment. My hub brakes were failing all over the place. They were jamming up and then not working at all, then jamming up. And I'm under there with a screwdriver. Like, I don't know if you know these old hub brakes on the Dodges, you have to like pop a rubber cap off and then feed a screwdriver in towards your own face because you're reaching underneath and can't get at it. And I'm trying to drive down the 401, which is like Canada's busiest highway. And then like by the van, this is before I got the new tires, so the wind is like blowing it side to side. The brakes keep locking up. I'm like, I can't, I'm going to die on this highway, you know? I'm pulling over on every stop trying to fix it. Thought I fixed it, get out. Nope, back in again. And eventually I'm at a point where I'm sitting there. I'm so over it, or I'm having an argument with my girlfriend at the time, where like just my head is going to explode. I'm sitting in front of the van with my back to the bumper, middle of nowhere, just middle of absolute nowhere, but there's a dirt trail and these three people are walking down the trail. One of them with like a boombox, the other one with a cooler on his back, and then some girl dancing. It was like a moving party. And I had just been sitting there for 5 minutes trying to cool down, and all of a sudden these people come up. They're like, "Hey man, you look like you need a beer." Crack. They like hand it to me, this cold beer, and then like, "Party on, man." And they're just like, kept walking down the trail. They're like, we're 30 kilometers from the next house. Like, where are you going? But it was just this moment like, this is where I am right now. This is it. I'm having a beer that the stranger just gave me, listening to a boombox in the middle of nowhere. Like, that is an experience I'll never, you can't repeat.
Yeah.
It's just because of this misfortune, this crazy thing happened.
It seems as though you put yourself in those situations, it really does. And again, it kind of separates you from doing the day-to-day things. And once you experience that, it's kind of hard to go back.
Right.
It's kind of hard to experience.
Like, would I have ever experienced anything like that working at a sushi restaurant? Champ, that's enough. Come on. You've had it. You're good.
He's a playful pup.
His business is fetch. he's like, look, I bring you the ball, you throw the ball. It's a win-win scenario.
We're
sign the contract.
Yeah, working with Kobuk, it was the nervousness. And as you can hear, he's bouncing around behind us.
Yeah,
I'm sure he's okay in there. But that's part of it too. Eventually. You're working with your pups as you're traveling too. So
yeah, training never stops. He's nearly 13. I'm still training him.
Oh, it never stops.
Never ever stops. Right now we're trying to train him not to bark so damn much.
Well, it's good when you're in the van. He's your security system, right?
Well, worst security system ever. You reach into the van, he'd be like, "I'm so happy to see you. I'm not going to bark at all."
He'd be wagging his tail, licking them
as they take through all my stuff.
Your camera gear. How's it been documenting your travels on YouTube? I mean, you mentioned that, you know, you have a connection with people. You're able to reach out to people. It's a good gateway. But how has it been documenting everything you're doing? Has it become something that you're used to doing day after day? Like, when you see something beautiful and cool, I mean, how it is for me, it's like, man, I got to film this. I have to show what it's right. like. Or is it, not that it's a burden, but it's part of your traveling now.
Well, I got into it to become a better storyteller. So I'm a pretty good storyteller when it comes to photography, but I'm a terrible storyteller when it came to video. I couldn't put together it. Part of it was like, I grew up speaking French, learned English in high school or elementary school. So I don't really have a firm grasp on either language. I'm not a linguist on any level, but I just always sucked at telling stories. So I thought, okay, if I make all these videos and I just make a lot of them, eventually I'll be good at it and
right.
I'll be able to tell a story. And so that's always been my focus, to tell stories, to tell either the stories of people I meet or my own story, the goods, the bads, everything. Try to encapsulate like authentically just how, you know, how crappy and how great this life is.
Because it definitely is both. It is definitely.
I've had some of my worst days and all of my best days in a van.
It's hard to. Absolutely. Like mobily, like some form of traveling has been like, it's an interesting way to put it, to best and worst days.
Yeah.
It definitely
it's
comes.
It's kind of the same
around.
Way I think about America because I'm Canadian. It's the best and worst country on earth.
How so? Because
it's a country loaded with extremists. On every end of every spectrum, you'll meet just the wildest people in this country, and I love it. I love every moment of it. It's also, you'll meet the worst people in the world here.
Yeah,
you'll also meet the best people in the world here.
It's definitely,
but like you said, 95% of people are just fantastic.
95% of the people are trying to do the best they can. The other five,
well, verdict's still out on them.
It reminds me of the old crab pot motif. The crabs aren't stuck in there because of any type of netting. They're stuck in there because other crabs pull them down. You know, right. That's kind of something that's been a hard lesson for me to learn. I think traveling, you know, kind of taught me that.
Also, nobody ever thinks of the bad guy in their own story.
Oh,
everyone thinks of the hero of their own story.
Everybody has their own narrative.
Right. So
if I were in charge.
So you know what? You know what, man? We'll leave Kobuk in charge. Everyone gets face licks and playtime.
Yeah.
Times a day.
As long as somebody's around all the time. There's no being left alone.
No, no one ever gets left alone. No puppy left behind. That's the system he'd established.
How,
he's a socialist then, I guess.
Oh, absolutely. How's your pup? Whenever you have to leave him in the van, or does he come with you everywhere?
Well, fine? You know, I even before the van, I adjusted my life to let him. So I'd like shop specifically at places that would let my dog in, and you know, I do that. I try to bring him out every time I can, everywhere I go, as much as possible. if I knew, even if I was going to a shoot and I knew the client loved dogs, I'd bring my dog with me. I just straight up, like, there, I even shot a wedding with my dog there once.
No way.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, they wanted, they were like, yeah, bring the dog.
So this is a question that I always struggle with, and I ask it to a lot of people doing this lifestyle, is do you feel as though this lifestyle, I mean, it's always been here in one form, one way or another, but do you feel as though the internet has expanded this lifestyle?
Yeah, this and every other lifestyle.
People find their subgroups.
Everyone is all of a sudden, like, it used to be that you'd have to be told about an idea like this to hear about it. Now you can just Google it.
Right. So, like, the amount of people listening to this podcast, watching this video, you know, especially if they're this far in, how deeply they're interested in this lifestyle.
Exactly. They're deeply interested in it. They're watching vloggers, which is a very specific niche. That means that you want to know exactly what this lifestyle looks like up and down, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's something that wasn't available to us before. And that allows you also to, like, commit to this lifestyle knowing, having a good, pretty good representation of what it's going to be like.
Right.
Which is a really big asset, you know?
Yeah, we talked about it briefly, people on social media, people that have their online presence.
Yeah.
Then they have their real presence, like you, to get into details, but a certain personality that is projecting one thing, and then you get there and it's
totally
different. I think people just have to be careful on, Not saying what we do is anything better than anybody else, but you have to be careful of what is the sugar-coated, you know, like, give me views type thing.
Did you see the one I did with Kirsten Dirtz and whatever?
She does the... I'm going to have to check that out. I really like her.
With her called... it took me like months and months to film it all.
Really?
Called Van Life No Filter. # Van Life No Filter.
I'll have to check that out.
It was the whole thing's about how, like, I got into van dwelling because of Instagram. Because basically I'd found these two photographers I really liked. I love their work, and their work exploded. It got so much better and so much more interesting because they were able to live nomadically, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they were doing a guy alone with his dog traveling in a van. So I was like, wow, I could do that. That's crazy. But the reality of that # van life was like, it's a steep learning curve. And it is to get, like, people want to share the best photos. People don't share necessarily, like, you know, breaking down and all this other stuff. They don't share, like, the downsides. And they're also downsides that are hard to explain sometimes too, right?
So, and also, like, for us, like, we have our things that we want to show, like the real, whether it be real or whatever.
I'm totally guilty. My Instagram feed is, like, just a bunch of gorgeous star photos and crazy camping
stuff. But there's also stuff, like, personally, like, for me and my channel, I don't like doing, like kissing G or, like, doing any type of that stuff. I just think it's cheesy.
Right.
Almost.
But that's your preference too, right? Like, I met the vloggers that came by, and they're a couple vlogger, and they got into vlogging as, like, the relationship part of it.
Really?
So the van dwelling was secondary. That's, like, something they only got into a year and a half into vlogging. So, like, they were really well established as a couple. And now they've sold the van, and they're having a kid. They're married. They're having a kid. They have a house. They got a house now. Like, and their vlogging is all about their relationship. So there is opposite ends of the spectrum. This is, to me, it's not my thing, but, like, it exists out there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's
relationship vlogs, like the family vlogs.
It's so weird. It's not, I can't, I can't understand why it's popular.
I can't either.
You know?
But I mean,
most popular channels on YouTube are people playing Minecraft, like, I don't understand that either.
Right. But I mean, in the same token, they probably look at us bopping around the country, filming this stuff that they might not completely understand, but it is odd to me. Like, how people, they just have a house and they just blog about their kids going to school and stuff. It's to teach their own. Teach their own.
But this is the thing, right? People tune in to see what that life is like.
Right.
They want to know. Maybe they're looking at having kids instead of buying a van.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Yeah, that's what makes the world a great place. All the differences, right?
That's it, man. And so I'm curious because it's hard to talk about sometimes. Like, we were talking about, like, I'm very open about, like, okay, I want to go Arctic Circle. I want to do Southeast Asia. Okay, I want to get a sailboat. Okay, I want to, like, motorcycle trip across Eastern Europe, or I want to do, you know, all these things. and my channel will come with me through all of those. But like this guy, this isn't the end of the road for you, you know. This is not where you and YouTubing too, like, where are you going with it? What's the next one? Do you know yet?
I don't, man. Like, it's kind of like...
You never know those things.
Yeah.
I don't know, for sure.
And again, okay, so two aspects to this. Number one is, once you get a taste for the do-your-own-thing lifestyle, the traveling lifestyle, you can never go back.
No.
Number two is, you really... I mean, for... The way that I kind of look at my life and the way of the traveling is the same way I did this this interview. It wasn't... We didn't talk about any... I asked, hey, do you want to do a podcast? And you went to your van, you grabbed, I think, your camera for a time lapse. I set up chairs, I hooked up the mics, set up the cameras, and we sat down and started talking. Like,
there's no script.
Right.
You don't know what you're doing.
Exactly. It's the exact same thing. So
what are the kinds of things you'd like to do then? Because this is the thing. I don't know. Like, I'd like to go to Southeast Asia. I haven't bought my plane ticket. I don't know where I'm staying. I don't know where I'm going. I have things I'd like to do.
Right.
And this is when I'm researching for the trip, the van trip, I use an app called My Maps.
Mm-hmm.
And I just fill it with points of interest I'd like to see. Every time somebody tells me about something cool, I'll jot it down on there. And then when I'm traveling, I don't plot them all together. Okay, I'll go this on Thursday and that on Friday. And I don't plot it months ahead. I just go, right, I'm in northwest, I guess, northwestern Arizona. I don't know. And then I'd be like, okay, what's points near me? And I just pull up the map and be like, oh, those are cool, but I don't feel like doing that. Okay, this one's cool, and I don't feel like doing that. And I just go do it. And that would be my tomorrow. Who knows?
No, I mean, for me, I'm kind of in the same way, but it's on a kind of a smaller timeline with my life in general. Like, I do know that I want to keep traveling, and who knows what's going to happen with this rig or a fifth wheel.
My plan only goes to Wednesday right now.
Right, exactly.
As far as it goes.
Exactly. So it's like that's kind of how I view the whole thing.
Which makes us extremely difficult to meet up with, in case you're wondering.
Right.
I try really hard to meet up with people when they offer me through my channel, but like, it is very difficult. Like, it was difficult for you and me to like trace each other down. You thought I was like,
I thought that you were north,
100 kilometers north of here. I came from the south of him, which is,
and it's like we're like, both what? And we're both completely free to do what we want when we want, and how difficult that was.
It's still difficult, you know, to meet, I mean? Up. Yeah.
No, it's, I think there's just a lot to be said. Maybe it's just our personalities, just in general, but just. Like, not having set plans, like when you have set plans, and this is the difficult part with Alaska for us. Yeah. Alaska is one of the most beautiful places. I love the drive through BC and Yukon. It's an amazing, amazing trip, but it's a hindrance to our life because, and again, I'm saying Alaska is a hindrance to our life as we take this road trip.
Right.
Bear that in mind. But just the reality of being back there, you know, 5 months down the road, we're going to have to be back in Alaska. You know,
gonna
it's
have to.
Yeah.
Twist his arm.
So it's like, it's crazy
then
that no. It's I'm saying like it, I do want to do it, but it's crazy that is something that's part of our reality, where not having that set plan 5 months away for a beautiful spot is like, it's something that's hard for me
it's
to
difficult.
Do. It's, yeah. And it's
that's
crazy
why,
to think
that's
about
why I
that.
I shut down my wedding business.
Yeah, because you
this
had to
my
be
last season. I've had like so many requests for next year. Like, I just turned down like upwards of $40,000 worth of work or $50,000 worth of work.
Wow.
Just because like, I'm like, I can't be like 14 months from now. I can't say, yes, I'll go shoot your
right.
wedding. I can't do that.
And
I love it. I love shooting weddings. There's nothing like, it sounds weird for me to say, cause photographers are always like, I hate weddings. I love it. I love shooting weddings. Don't really want to get married personally, but like I love getting you to be part of someone's life on the most
right.
important part of their day, and you're like you're right next to them all day. You're
right.
Like, I'm your best friend. I'm with
right.
you shooting your wedding.
So right? you get a little view into their life.
And I'm a friend for life now. Mm-hmm. I can't like all my wedding clients have me on like every social media.
That's
I
awesome.
just got a Facebook message from one of my first wedding clients. Sent me a picture of their new son, who's like a year old, watching my videos.
That's
on YouTube.
Awesome.
He's got it.
That's so cool.
And he's just like, he's very adamantly watching every episode. Like, he's so into it. I'm like, that is so cool, you know? And I love it, but I can't. 14 months in advance, I couldn't do it anymore. I couldn't commit to that. I had this opportunity to, with the, not just the, like financially, because financially, really, the YouTube isn't really supporting anything.
No.
But, just the connections, like the amount of resources and connections, and also the fact that I'm filming it, and that forces me to force myself to like go and do more.
Oh yeah, absolutely. So
because I'm doing that, like, it was just like a now or never, like, just go do it. Just travel nonstop. Make it happen. Make it work. Go do it.
I think also another thing, like we were talking briefly, that when I first started, it was just me with a GoPro just saying what I was doing, and there was no storytelling. You're saying you're getting your story.
Storytelling.
Yeah, like
from the
get-go. Like you're
trying to learn how to do that.
Oh, absolutely. And I think something that's helped us, and I mean, YouTube's gone through a huge transformation, but we have creators now like Casey Neistat. Like people that we can actually look up to. Yeah. You know, like I look up to that guy. Like I don't look up to too many people.
It's funny. I look up to the Vlog Brothers. I look up to Casey, obviously, but like I look up as storytellers, I look up to the Vlog Brothers.
I have heard of them, but I haven't seen any of their videos.
The way that they make like video essays, kind of like Casey did.
Yeah.
Video essays almost. But it was like storytelling to its extreme where, and the funny thing is they do all of that by sitting at their desk. They sit at the same desk and film, like from their desk. Yeah, but they're storytellers.
Huh.
They're for sure storytellers.
I have to look into that.
The way they edit it, the way, like, it's totally, it's, that's storytelling. And it's funny because it's, like, if you want to look at specifics like camera angles or whatever, they're terrible for any kind of that advice. But on the meta level, like, the way they talk and the way they break down a story, it's super inspirational. It's crazy. It's not at all our genre at all, but... It helps.
Maybe we can take little pieces
from every genre out there. totally.
Put them
I'm
together.
Not even kidding. I watched my subscription feed on YouTube is bizarre.
Like, yeah,
I actually don't watch that many Van Dwellers at all.
I
watch like one or two people on sailboats. I watch a few other travel things, but most of them are like, I watch like some people playing video games. I watch some people who do how-to videos. I watch a channel that he doesn't ever talk and just makes stuff from primitive technology. Is it called Primitive Technologies? I love his channel. He just like, he posts like once a month and he posts like a video of him making a mud hut. Like
I think I've seen one of those.
Yeah.
That was a great video. Like it's sped great, up.
But he does. So I love pulling little bits of inspiration from every genre and trying to like, because if you just pull it from your own genre, you'll never get ahead.
Well, that's YouTube in general. I mean, we touched on it, but it's like YouTube is this huge educational platform now.
Yeah.
It started out as cat videos.
Yeah.
And
now it's like, now they outcompete cable networks.
Oh, absolutely. And like you can go on YouTube and watch a full college lecture.
Yeah. Or you can learn how to do anything, or you can be scared crap, like shit, you want horror movies and stuff.
Yeah.
You can watch sci-fi, like full-on sci-fi, like series. You can watch every kind of documentary, obviously. Every kind of like budget shoestring documentary made from any kind of person.
So what's your future with YouTube?
I'm just going to continue leveraging everything I possibly can out of it and just using it to like meet people to... hopefully one day makes enough to fund some part of my trip, which would be nice, but...
Well, if you do Southeast Asia...
It's cheap. That's what I hear.
You can...
Maybe.
We were living like kings and queens on about $20 a day.
Oh, God, that sounds...
More than that, 30.
Because I'm going to Baja this winter.
You'll have to keep in touch and let me know how that goes, because I heard it's pretty amazing.
For me, it's like, oh my God, tequilas, tacos, and surfing every day. That sounds amazing.
Yeah.
That'd be a life
I'd... And your van's perfect for it, and you have your bike.
Yeah, and I'm trying to gather a few other van dwellers to come down with me, too.
I've heard Baja is pretty amazing.
I'm trying to gather you to come down with me, but we'll see.
I don't know if we can get this thing down there.
Maybe.
If I had Zep down here.
I was trying to talk Matt and Danielle into flying down and living in the van. I told them, I'm like, I'll take the motorbike out and we'll go separate ways and we'll come with, and I'll just...
That'd
like
be camp. Pretty cool.
Oh, I'll sleep on the damn beach. I don't care. Like, that's fine. As long as I can, like, cook in it.
Absolutely. So if people were wanting to follow up with you, catch up with your travels, where would they
Simon
find you?
Finding Simon on everything.
Finding Simon, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook.
You just Google it. I have the domain, you know, everything. I even use Snapchat. I use,
nice.
You know, I'm on all of it, but mostly YouTube. Hit up that YouTube. Got lots of episodes up there now.
Going daily. I'm surprised you're able to watch anything. I can't watch anything on YouTube. I'm so busy doing stuff. By the time I get done editing and uploading, last thing I want to do is...
I flick
spend any more time on the computer.
Funny, there's just a few channels I flick on that I just can't not watch.
I mean, when Casey was blogging, that'd be my inspiration if I was halfway through the day.
I love watching Casey. Roadkill, two guys from California that do classic cars, and they'll take something from a junkyard and they'll pull an engine from another car in a junkyard and road trip at three states and then they'll drag race it at a race and then it breaks down six times on the way there and they, like, it's all just drama, crazy. It's reality car show, but that's actual reality. So it's like there's no...
That's smart. That's incredibly smart.
One of the most popular.
There's always something going wrong with cars.
Yeah, and they do nuts stuff.
Maybe that's something you should do with YouTube.
That's what I will do.
Buy RVs and take it across the country and document it breaking down all the time.
I'm going to go out west and then go up north, and then I'll probably sell this. And I was thinking of getting a classic car and taking it from the west back to the east. And I'll do a roadkill special on it or something.
That'd be cool. But yeah, you can check him out on there. Is there anything else you want to add before we finish up here?
Oh, man, thanks for having me out.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
It's cool meeting you after 2 years of watching you.
It's pretty crazy.
You mess up on YouTube.
It's a small world out there,
dude. And what's cool is that when you meet people from YouTube, they're usually just like they are on their videos. He's exactly like he is on his videos.
That's a compliment. That's a goal to achieve.
It is, and you do well.
Yeah, thanks. You too, man. I'm gonna have to start watching some of your videos.
Oh yeah, start. Yeah.
And also some of those channels
you're
talking
about.
I don't
really watch your stuff. I was just kidding. Not really that big.
Well, if you guys ever do get on YouTube and you start posting, you're going to realize how much time and energy and how much, whenever you finish editing and uploading, how hard it is to click on a video.
Mm-hmm. Especially when your internet connection is limited to 3 hours a day. 3 hours every other day, for instance, yeah.
Well, thanks for watching, everybody. Once again, be sure to check out Simon, and catch y'all later.